You're listening to the audio production of I Want God, How to Love Him with Your Whole Heart and Revive Your Soul by Lisa Whittle, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author. A note before we begin, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider. It contains 40 questions to take your own inventory and 40 daily fasts, and will be referred to throughout as the enhancement. To Mama, who has always wanted God most. When you get desperate for God or feel desperate in general, read this. A note from Lisa. While the foundation of this message can be used any time of year, as I reviewed these words with fresh eyes, I intentionally thought about I Want God in the context of Lent. The season of Lent is the 40 days before Easter, from Ash Wednesday to Resurrection Sunday. During this time, Christians are encouraged to go deeper with God and prepare their hearts through prayer and fasting. Participating in these practices during Lent can make Christ's sacrifice and return to glory even more meaningful. Lent can be a powerful time of personal reflection and self-depletion to gain more of God. Revival is always about a fresh wind, fresh fire from the Holy Spirit. There is a natural tie here. I realize my suggestion to use this book with a Lenten focus isn't traditional, but a message of wanting God is most appropriate in a season of intentional pursuit of Christ. No one wants you to have the most life more than your Creator. For those reasons, I trust this book will be an important resource for you in this particular season. If you are looking for more ways to lean into the Lenten message, I have crafted a 40-day I Want God challenge that would be perfect for this season or for any other time of the year. In the enhancement, you will find 40 questions to take your own inventory, followed by 40 daily fasts, each a short statement designed to help you hand more over to God and, in the process, gain more of Him. Part 1. God Knows. Chapter 1. I Want God More. God is feeding me, and what I'm praying for is an appetite. Flannery O'Connor. I sit, wringing sweaty 6-year-old hands in the back seat of Mama's massive 70s boat on wheels, trying to muster the courage to tell her I've met God. She is the least judgmental person I know, and the one who loves Him most. But I remember our recent talk in the yellow kitchen about not asking Him into my heart because it is the good girl thing to do, but waiting until I really want Him, and I fear she may think I'm not ready. We are in the parking lot of Judon's Hot Dogs, and we have just been to night church. My mind is still dancing over what has taken place that evening inside the stained glass windowed walls, the glorious but curious display of Jesus. Church people I know in ninja-looking head sashes, hairy men's feet stuffed in Walmart sandals meant to look Roman, grown adults and young children with pumped fists shaking, saying words they don't mean, like, "Crucify him," portraying the back-then crowd. Someone calls this curious display of Jesus a passion play, and I overhear it. I am intrigued. It is the first passion play I have ever seen. By the time the play ends and my daddy's best preacher voice booms through the worship room to invite those who don't know Christ to accept Him, my heart is a whirlpool and I am twirling inside. It is the impatient sound of my brother's voice claiming starvation that cuts through these thoughts. I stop spinning long enough to travel back to the back seat. "I am so hungry," he laments in my ear. I bob to the surface to inhale real life in the scent of a foot-long hot dog. I don't want it, and that surprises me. Judon's hot dogs are among my favorite things in the world. But I'm too busy thinking about Walmart sandals meant to look Roman The Eyes of a Guy Playing Jesus, and my best friend, Kathy. Kathy is playful and funny, and I feel playful and funny when I am with her. Her daddy is a deacon, which makes us a perfect pair. Thinking about her sweeps me away to the things that just took place, and suddenly I have rewound so far that the night's events are starting over. We enter the worship room and take our seats in the front row, eager for the Jesus show. The lights dim and the show begins, and I think Kathy is watching, but I'm not sure. I hope she is, because I'll need to talk to her later about what my eyes are recording. I'm glued to the display of scenes Daddy and Mama have read to me out of that enormous white family Bible, scenes that didn't wear reality until now, and I am all in, start to finish. It is after the Jesus man has ascended in a white robe in a billowing cloud of smoke to loud claps and cheers that my daddy speaks in his preacher voice, and I hear Kathy. Daddy has taken the stage to tell people they too can know this Jesus and to repeat his words with their lips and heart. With his every word, Kathy is repeating them, soft enough for only me to hear, but to me they sound megaphoned. Dear Jesus, I know I am a sinner. Please come into my life and save me. It's a weird voice she's using, and I don't like it. It sounds silly and sing-songy and not at all like it's coming from her. A giggle escapes, and I know for sure it is something she is saying to be funny and not something that is real. My 6-year-old heart, which knows nothing of the Pharisee, feels grieved and righteous. How can Kathy pretend to mean such important words when God can hear them? I'm embarrassed for both of us and worried my father will hear her and give us the look, the one I've seen him give teenagers in the church sometimes when they are being loud. But more than anything, I'm wondering why I feel something so strong it is squeezing the breath from me, something of crosses and angry crowds and Jesus and small, young me. I have heard about this Savior many times already, but I've never really seen him. And I am aware for the first time that my universe is about more than playing with stray kittens in my treehouse fort outside my country home. I want God for the first time, and it consumes every 6-year-old square inch of me. I want to know him and touch him and never hurt his heart. I want to love him and feel his love back. I want to talk to him like they say I can with the simple words I know. I want to be funny about other things, but never about him on a cross. I want to tell God I want him, and I want to mean it. And so, with loud voice in heart, I repeat the words my preacher daddy is saying where only God can hear them. I have shuttered my eyelids closed so I won't see Kathy or anyone else. I want no distractions. I am more serious about Jesus than my years say I should be, more serious than I've ever been about anything else. I feel like a sprinter running towards something grand, and it makes me feel brave and full and honest. I want God, and I want him to know it. With little girl courage and tiny sweaty palms, I repeat these things and the whole story to my mama from the back seat of her boat on wheels in the parking lot of Judon's Hot Dogs. And while the hot dogs get cold, and my voice tells the way I met Jesus, my mama cries, like all mamas who want their kids to know the Great One do. Forgetting. For me, as for you, it is important to remember my first encounter with Jesus. Because as calendar days fly away and life becomes noisy, those of us who know God often forget how badly we once wanted him. Maybe then the irony is true. We who have much are often the most in need because we have forgotten how it feels to be desperate. And let's be honest, it almost seems unfair of God to stick us in a world where we are likely to fail to live the 1 Corinthians 7:31 life, The those who use the things of the world should not become attached to them life. That's a near impossibility and seems to just get harder with every new gadget, every activity, every house built in the suburbs, every child born into a world that tells them they are entitled. We struggle with having so much we want and, at the same time, still wanting God. So it is of no surprise that we are surprised when we remember him and the want stirs. We walk by the mirror one day and catch a glimpse of fixed hair and lipsticked lips and ties with perfect knots nestled in crisp collared shirts, and what we see looks crude and incomplete. And we wonder why we have never noticed before how perfection can be so flawed and how comfort can feel so uncomfortable, and we mourn the life we have right in front of us. And something inside us longs to take the back of our hand and smear off the lipstick, pull off the tie, rattle the everyday stale life cage we found ourselves in, run into the street, find the pulse again, the pulse that has us beating to the wild of God. But instead, life ticks, and numbly we move to it. The stirring gets pushed into an emotional trash compactor that keeps packing it down deeper to make room for more stuff. Schedules, carpools, calculated risk. Before we leave the image in the mirror, we make quick promises about how one day we will change and become all in for you, God. Only we don't use those words because those words require us to take action. We say instead, tomorrow I'll be better, with the reservation of a half heart that is torn between the now life and the one that started when we first drank truth. We walk away and we forget. We forget what it feels like to come with open hands and heart. How we were once awed by the story of in the beginning, water into wine, love held by nails, the veil torn, resurrected life. We forget the power and the commitment, the beauty and the magnitude, the promises, the relationship, the raw passion for the cause and the reason, and the immaculate saving grace. We forget God. And sometimes, when the missionary comes to church with pictures, when the neighbor adopts and we touch the baby skin of a child born of a different mother, we catch that small glimpse of him again and remember how we've forgotten. And our throats swell and limbs tingle as they begin to regain their feelings stirred by the greatness we recall. And more than anything else, we want to want, but the want seems unfamiliar and scary, and speaks harshly to the spiritual rigor mortis that is set in from years of forgetting. So instead, we just do. We write out a Be Better plan. We read a Be Better book. We follow someone's Be Better strategy. We pursue being better in ways we know and can control. But what we don't remember is that the people who go hard for God are not the ones who try the hardest. They are the ones who want him more than anything else. More. We learn a lot by asking the right questions. My friend Monty does this, asks good questions, learns a lot. It is in a car that I first encounter his game of inquisition on a winding road between trees and more trees, tires humming me to sleep. He suggests a game of questions, and I dive blindly in, grateful for the break in monotony. The questions come in a variety pack, from, if you could have any other first name, what would it be? To, if you could do anything and it weren't a sin, what would you do? My husband, driving, answers them too, much to my intrigue. He would want his name to be Austin? Interesting, what even 10 years of marriage do not let you know. I am learning things about me too, how little I know of the things I don't need to consider in my daily life. Where would I want to be stranded if my plane crashed and I survived? Silly, the pragmatist says in me, because I wouldn't. What would I want to eat if I could only eat one thing for the rest of my life? Not one thing in those terms sounds good enough, by the way. Monty is asking the right questions, the ones that have me interested and stirred, and most of all, thinking. It reminds me of something similar from my...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.